The box was marked Kitty's Need Home, and it was tucked beneath a window on a busy street. Now, this wasn't just any old street. It was Fifth Avenue in the middle of big, bustling, rough, tough New York City. The town's a hard place for anybody to find a home, even if you're the cutest little kittens anybody ever saw.
Now, it's always once upon a time in New York City. It's a big old battle, tough old town, it's true. But beginnings are contagious there. They're always setting stages there. They're always turning pages there for you. Ain't it great the way it all begins in New York City? Right away you're making time and making friends. No one cares. Once upon a time in New York City. And it's always once upon a time in New York City.
Mewing, the kittens pawed the sides of the box, hoping the passersby would notice. As the day wore on, some people did step out of the crowd and reach down to select a favorite. Soon the box was empty, save for one scared ginger-colored kitten. That night, rain streamed into the box, then swept the kitten onto the curb. Everything looked so strange. As he stared at a car whizzing by, a pack of dogs rushed up. The kitten escaped over a chain-link fence and spent the night perched on the tire of a parked car. The next morning, he made his way to the sidewalk. Suddenly, his nose twitched.
Hey, come on, folks. Step right up. Get your hot dogs. The best hot dogs in New York.
The hungry kitten marched up to the vendor and crawled onto his shoe to get his attention.
Step right up. Hey, get out of this shoe. Get out of here. Go on, kitty.
Just then, a brown-spotted mutt named Dodger strolled by.
Well, well. It looks like Louie's got a visitor. Could be time for the Dodge to turn this into a total catastrophe.
He watched the sausage man toss the kitten onto a pile of garbage, then sauntered over.
Oh, you sure picked the wrong guy to get hot dogs from, kid.
Get away from me.
Whoa, chill out, man. I don't eat cats. It's too much fur. I've been watching you, and I think you're in serious need of some professional guidance. And what do you say we team up and change old Louie's mind about sharing some of those hot dogs?
I'm not going back there again.
Hey, it'll be a snap, kid. I'm an expert at these things. All you gotta do is learn some moves.
Moves?
You know, tempo, a rhythm. This city's got a beat. You gotta hook into it. And once you got the beat, you can do anything.
I can?
Absolutely, positively. The man you see before you is affectionately known as Old Louie, a well-known enemy of the four-legged world. Our mission, Cat, is to liberate those all-beef kosher Franks and hightail it out of here. Starting to feel that rhythm?
Well, Yeah, I do feel it. When are we gonna get those hot dogs?
Right now.
The frightened kitten scrambled straight up Louie's shirt.
Hey, get out of here, you... Hey!
While Louie tangled with the kitten, Dodger swiped a string of hot dogs and trotted off. The kitten leaped to the ground and raced after Dodger, following him across a construction site.
Hey, you really got that rhythm, kid.
Yeah, we were good, huh? So when are we gonna eat?
We?
Yeah, I'm starving.
Listen, kid, I hate to break it to you, but the dynamic duo is now the dynamic uno. Our partnership is herewith dissolved.
But wait, you're not being fair.
Fair's a for tourists, kid. Consider it a free lesson in street savoir-faire from New York's coolest quadruped. Check you later.
Hey, wait! I helped you get those! Half of those are mine!
The kitten chased the dog across the construction yard, hopping over sawhorses and cable cores. Dodger glanced back at him.
You want them? Come and get them.
Dodger led the kitten on a frantic chase through the city. The dog's pals were gathered inside an old barge at the waterfront. A chihuahua named Tito sorted through the loot he had found that day, then danced up to a portly bulldog.
Hey, Frankie, man, what you watching, man? Hey, does he get the girl? I mean, what happens?
Shut up, you little rodent.
Hey, man, this stuff is boring, man. Come on, let's watch some boxing, man. I want to see some action.
The bulldog swatted at Tito.
Hey, Frankie, ¿qué pasó, man? You're getting slow, man.
My name is Francis. Francis. Not Frank. Not Frankie. Francis.
No kidding, man. Hey, so what did you bring in today, Francis?
It's none of your business, you intrusive little pipsqueak.
Look what I got.
An old Great Dane lumbered over, proudly displaying a broken tennis racket.
A good show, Einstein. Now all we need is the court and the net.
You think this place is big enough?
Hey, come on, what we need is some good quality stuff, man.
An Afghan hound named Rita stepped between them and studied the contents of the loot box.
Fagan's not going to be too happy about this. So, Francis, you got the food, right?
Well, no, I...
Oh, Frankie. Was your turn to get the food today?
It's newspaper burritos again.
Suddenly, a string of hot dogs landed at their feet. The gang looked up.
Cool it, Dodger fans. I'd like to introduce you to your dinner. Hot dogs,
a la Dodger. Hot dogs, all right, Dr. Mann.
So how'd you do it this time, Dodgy baby?
Let me tell you, Rita, it was tough. Only I could have done it.
As Dodger launched into his story, a small figure crawled onto the barn's roof, then peered through a crack at the dogs below.
Picture the city, 8th and Broadway. The crowds hustling, the traffic roaring, the hot dogs are sizzling. Enter Dodger, one bad puppy, not just out for himself, but community-minded. But he's not the only one out there. Enter the opposition, a greedy, ugly, psychotic monster with razor-sharp claws, dripping fangs, and 9 lives, all of them hungry. He comes at me, eyes burning. I knew my time had come. Suddenly,
the ceiling collapsed and something plummeted into a pile of laundry.
Take cover!
The entire gang dove out of the way. Rita was the first to poke her head out and examine the squirming bundle. It was the kitten.
Now, how'd you find this place, cat?
I followed this dog.
Hey, kitty, what took you so long?
The gang stared at Dodger, who was lounging comfortably in front of the TV.
Dripping fangs.
I kind of like those burning eyes.
Come on, let's see this big bad kitty fight in action.
Hey, Tito, look.
Tito glanced behind him, and Dodger jabbed at the Chihuahua. The dogs tumbled out of the chair onto Francis and Einstein.
Oh, what a bunch of overgrown...
Just then, the door opened, and in walked the gang's master, a scruffy old man named Fagin. He frowned at the squabbling dogs.
All right, knock it off. What's the matter with you guys? Don't you understand? Sykes will be here any minute. And I don't have his...
No.
The dogs jumped on Fagin to welcome him.
No, stop it.
No licking.
Wait. What joke?
All right, settle down.
Sykes. All right. I'm coming. I'll be right there.
Fagin grabbed the loot box and frantically inspected it.
It's worthless. What have you done? Oh, how are we ever going to pay Sykes off with a pussycat?
Fagin held up the kitten who had been hiding at the bottom of the box. As he stared at it, 2 Dobermans stalked into the room.
Oh, look who's here, kids. Company. Nice doggies. I was... just on my way out.
Outside the barge, Fagin stumbled toward the blinding lights of a parked car. He edged his way along the dock to the driver's side.
Oh, hello. Oh, lovely evening. I was just saying this to your 2 lovely, pure men.
Money, Fagin.
Actually, I've got something much better than money. Some luxury items.
I don't want your garbage, Fagin.
Oh, please, Sykes. Oh, please. Oh, please, sir, please.
Mr. Fagin.
Sorry.
Now, I lent you money, and I don't see it. Do you know what happens when I don't see my money, Fagin? People get hurt. People like you get hurt. Do I make myself clear?
Oh, please. Oh, please. Oh, please.
3 sunrises, 3 sunsets, 3 days, Fagin. 3.
3? Oh, you mean just 3 days? Oh, my goodness. Oh, I'm having a bad day.
Meanwhile, the Dobermans were inside the barge confronting the gang. While DeSoto sniffed around the room, Roscoe sidled up to Rita.
You know, Rita, I can't figure out why you'd rather hang around a dump like this when you could be living uptown with a class act like myself.
Isn't it rather dangerous to use one's entire vocabulary in a single sentence?
Hey, Frankie, get down, Riley. You bad, really.
In the meantime, DeSoto had discovered the kitten hiding behind an ironing board.
Hey, Roscoe. Look what I found. I like cats. I like to eat them.
Baring his teeth, the Doberman advanced. The kitten squeezed his eyes shut and swiped his claw across DeSoto's nose.
No!
The kitten froze, and Roscoe leaped to DeSoto's defense. Dodger sprung in front of him.
Get out of my way, Dodger.
That's enough, Roscoe.
Run along, Roscoe. Your master's calling.
Come on, DeSoto. We ain't finished, Dodger. You guys are gonna pay for this. Starting with that cat.
The Dobermans exited the barge, and as soon as they were gone, Dodger grinned at the kitten.
All right, kid. What'd I tell you guys? Old Dodge can really pick 'em, huh?
Fagin staggered into the room and slumped into a chair.
Oh, 3 days. How am I ever gonna come up with all that money? What's the use? I'll never get out from under that maniac. It's hopeless. That reminds me. I saw DeSoto's nose. Who did that?
Dodger nudged the kitten towards Fagin.
You? That took a lot of guts. We've never had a cat in the gang before. We can use all the help we can get. All right, time for bed. We've got a big day tomorrow.
Soon the dogs were fast asleep, with Oliver snuggled up next to Dodger, his newfound friend. The next morning, Fagin and the gang sped downtown on Fagin's trike, a motor scooter rigged up with a shopping cart to hold the dogs.
Well, gang, this is the big one. We've got 2 days to do or die. Dodger, you keep an eye on the new kid. Show him the ropes. I don't want to put any undue pressure on you. But as you march off to do your duty, I want you to keep one thing in mind. Dead men do not buy dog food. So big smiles and get out there and fetch.
Fagin roared off and Dodger led the gang down the street.
All right, if Mr. Sykes don't see some cold hard cash soon, we are Doberman Chow.
Come on, we'll start on Columbus Avenue.
What kind of work do we do anyway?
Investment banking, man. Didn't you read about us in the Wall Street Journal?
Really?
Yes, captains of industry.
Gosh, can I be one too?
Hey, when you got your pals, you got all you need.
Okay, Dodge.
Dodger glanced over at Rita and she winked at Oliver.
We gotta clean you up, child, and give you some on-the-job training. Ooh, yeah. Now listen up, you got a lot to learn. And if you don't learn, you don't eat. But if you're tough and always use your head, you'll be right at home on the street. When you got talent, everything is free. Watch how we do.
Please! Watch how we do things. Ooh, I can't hear your notes.
As Rita was finishing her song, Dodger spotted a limousine turning the corner.
Hello. What have we here?
All right, a chauffeur shuffle.
Listen up. Einstein, give me a fender bender and two lights. Tito, you're in charge of electronics. Rita and I will work the crowd.
Francis?
I know. My public awaits.
Inside the limousine, a little girl named Jenny was reading a letter to her chauffeur.
Oh, Winston, listen to this. After a little sightseeing, we left Paris by car for the conference,
Jennifer.
Oh, yes, conference. In Rome on Wednesday. Jenny, I'm afraid your father and I won't be able to make it.
Is there anything wrong, Jenny? Are your parents all right?
They're staying longer.
Oh, don't worry. I'm sure they'll be home for your birthday.
No.
Suddenly, a heavy object slammed into the car.
What was that?
I don't know, but don't be alarmed. I'll be right back.
Einstein, who had purposely thrown himself against the car, lumbered off down the street just as Winston opened the door and got out. The chauffeur looked down and saw Francis moaning and groaning as if in pain.
Oh, poor thing.
You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
I'm sure he's just fine.
Why don't you help that poor dumb animal?
Run along, little fellow. Go on now. Shoo.
Meanwhile, Tito and Oliver hopped into the driver's seat of the limousine. As the kitten watched Tito disconnect the car radio, he heard a noise from the back seat.
Hey, Tito. Tito, there's something back there.
Hey, stop hassling me, man. I only got one more wire, okay?
What? The kitten jumped down and accidentally caught his paw in the ignition keyring, causing the alarm to go off. The electricity sent Tito streaking out of the car.
What in the world? What's going on here?
Let's get out of here!
Francis jumped out of Winston's arms, and Dodger led the gang to an alley where the charred Tito coughed up black smoke. Dodger looked around for Oliver.
He must have been in the car, man!
You were supposed to keep an eye on him, Tito.
Yeah, well, it's hard to watch anything when you're getting barbecued, man.
What are we gonna do, Dodge?
Tito, come with me. The rest of you, get back to Fagin.
The dogs followed the limousine to an elegant townhouse on Fifth Avenue and watched Jenny carry the kitten inside.
Don't worry, kitty. I'll take care of you.
Georgette is not going to like this.
Upstairs, a purebred poodle was just waking for the day. Georgette yawned and stretched, then stepped over to her dressing table and gazed into the mirror.
Girl, we've got work to do. Pass me the paint and glue. Perfect isn't easy, but it's me. When one knows the world is watching, one does what one must. Some minor adjustments, darling, not for my vanity, but for humanity. Each little step opposed. See how the breeding shows. Sometimes it's too much for even me. But when all the world says yes, then who am I to say no? Don't ask a mutt to strut like a showgirl. No, girl, you need a pro. Not a flea or a flaw. Take a peek at that paw. La-di-da. Perfection becomes meanness. Paw. Unrivaled, unruffled. I'm beauty unleashed. Yeah. Jaws drop, hearts stop. So classic and classy, we're not talking lassie. And
In the kitchen, Jenny prepared breakfast for the kitten, whom she had named Oliver.
I bet you're starved, huh? Where do you taste this? The secret recipe I just invented.
My goodness, Jenny! Don't you think a tin of kitty chow would have sufficed?
Nonsense! He'll love this!
Jenny poured the concoction into a gold bowl adorned with the letter G. The phone rang, and Winston hurried to answer it.
Jenny, it's your parents!
Yeah! Wait till I tell him.
Jenny ran out of the kitchen as Georgette sashayed in.
A cat! What is the meaning of this? Bark! Bark! Winston! Bark! 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 I guess I'll have to handle this myself.
Hello?
Hello.
I hope you won't think me rude, but do you happen to know out of whose bowl you're eating?
Yours?
Ooh, aren't you a clever kitty? And do you have any idea whose home this is?
I thought it was Jenny's.
Well, it may be Jenny's house. But everything from the doorknobs down is mine!
Oh, Georgette, I see you met Oliver. Isn't he cute? I've got great news. Mom and Dad just said I could keep him. I'm sure you two are going to be the best of friends.
Later that day, Jenny was at the piano when Oliver plunked onto the keys.
Oh, you want to practice too?
You and me together.
Jenny took the kitten to a fancy jewelry shop and selected a gold pendant. When she hung it around the kitten's neck, he saw that it had been engraved with his name, Oliver, and the address, 1125 Fifth Avenue. That night, Oliver slept on a pillow next to Jenny and dreamed about his new home. Across town, Dodger and Tito caught up with the gang.
Where's the kid?
We tail him all the way up the park. We never had a chance.
You should see this place, man. There's gotta be maybe 200 people living there.
Hey guys, we can't let the kid take the heat for us.
Yeah, man. If we don't get him, they're gonna torture that kid.
What in heaven's name are we waiting for?
Well, what about Fagin?
First, we'll spring the kid. Then we'll take care of the old man. All right?
Yeah, that's right, man. He's family. He's blood.
Here, here.
Okay, troops. Our mission begins at daybreak. Einstein, go up to the door. Francis, you're the front man.
The next day, the gang waited outside Jenny's house until she left for school. Then Einstein rang the doorbell with his nose and ran to hide in the bushes. Francis threw himself in front of the door and began whimpering the moment Winston opened it.
Yes? Who is it?
Oh! Oh!
Oh, my!
When Winston stepped outside, the gang dashed into the house. Francis jumped up, ran past the startled chauffeur, and locked the door behind him.
Come back here!
He followed the others upstairs, where the first room they entered was Georgette's.
Who are you? What do you want? When?
Whoa! Calm down!
Don't come any closer. I knew this would happen one day.
You're barking up the wrong tree. It's not you I'm after.
It's not? It's not? Well, why not? What's the problem, Spot? Not good enough for you? I mean, do you even know who I am? 56 blue ribbons. 14 regional trophies. 6-time national champion!
Ooh, and we're all very impressed, right, guys?
Tito grabbed Georgette's paw and kissed it.
Very impressed. Allow me to introduce myself. I am Ignacio Alonso Julio Federico de Tito.
Get away from me, you little bug-eyed creep! What's going on here? Winston! Burk! Burk!
Relax, champ. We'll leave as soon as we get our cat.
If you think I'm intimidated by a bunch of flea-bitten dog pound rejects... Your cat? How stupid of me. You must be the friends he keeps talking about. Yes.
Georgette led the gang to Jenny's room, where she grabbed the sleeping kitten by the collar and stuffed him into a pillowcase.
Use the fire escape.
Hey, there's no time for long goodbyes, but here's something to remember me by, baby.
Tito tried to kiss Georgette, but the poodle tossed him down the fire escape steps.
Ooh, I think she likes me, man.
The gang hurried back to the barge and released Oliver from the sack.
Wait, what's going on, you guys?
It was just the rescue of the century. You should have seen Frankie handle that butler, man.
Oh, well, was rather good.
You okay, kid?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Hey, sure he is. He's back with his Uncle Tito.
I was happy there. Why did you guys take me away?
What, this place is not good enough for you anymore? Don't want to mix with the riff-raff?
No. I like you. I mean, I like every one of you, but there was a little girl. I just want to go back.
We never should have took him, Dodger.
Dodger, please.
You want to leave? Fine. There's the door.
Dodger turned his back on Oliver, and the kitten slunk from the room. As he slowly mounted the steps, someone reached down and scooped him up. It was Fagin. The old man carried Oliver onto the barge and collapsed in his chair, absent-mindedly toying with the pendant around the kitten's neck.
What's this? So that's where you've been. Looks like you're doing all right for yourself, Oliver. Your owner probably spends more money on catnip than we do on food in a month. He's probably worried sick about you, all alone in that big house with only his money to comfort him, only his millions and millions of dollars to... That's it! We're saved! Oh, what a plan. Oh, yes, paper! Oh, it's so great.
Fagin began feverishly writing a note.
Dear Mr. Rich... Mr. Very Rich.
While Fagin scribbled madly, Jenny arrived home from school.
Oliver! Oliver, I'm home!
Jenny searched her bedroom, then ran downstairs, where she found Georgette preening in front of the TV.
Georgette, help me find Oliver. Oliver! Oh, no bouncing! Oliver!
The poodle jumped down from her seat.
Oh, where could he be?
Jenny continued hunting for Oliver.
Here, kitty.
As she combed the area around the front door, she saw a letter and map sticking out of the mail slot.
Dear Mr. Very Rich Cat Owner Person.
Jenny read Fagin's note while Georgette pranced into the kitchen and threw Oliver's bowl in the garbage.
Whoops!
And if you don't bring the money, you'll never see your cat again. Oh, no.
Georgette minced into the room and Jenny hugged her.
Georgette, something terrible has happened. They've kidnapped Oliver.
Behind Jenny's back, the dog grinned wickedly.
Oh, Georgette, you loved him too. Don't worry, we're going to get him back.
That night, Fagin drove to Sykes' warehouse. There, the two men discussed Fagin's plan to lure Oliver's rich owner to the dock to pay a ransom for the kitten.
I'm proud of you, Fagin. Yeah, you're starting to think big. You've got 12 hours. And Fagin, this is your last chance.
Fagin hurried to the barge and waited outside for Oliver's owner. Suddenly, he heard someone weeping. He saw Jenny sitting on the pier with a bedraggled poodle beside her.
Listen, little girl, this is a tough neighborhood. You better go home.
But I can't. I'm lost.
Aw, gee. Lost? Well, I'd help you, but I'm kind of busy right now. What are you doing down here anyway?
I came to find my kitty.
Your kitty?
Look, I even brought this to get him back.
Oh, you brought a piggy bank.
That's all I have.
That's awful.
I know. And what kind of a person would steal a poor little kitty?
He must have been a poor, desperate man.
It's still wrong. And I'm so scared. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do.
Neither do I.
Wiping her eyes, Jenny turned to leave. Fagin hesitated, then reached into his pocket and found Oliver.
Hey, guess what? I found a little lost kitten. I don't know. Take a look. Maybe he's yours.
Oliver! Oliver! Oh, my Oliver.
Suddenly, Fagin was blinded by the headlights of a limousine.
Sykes! Sykes! I was just...
The car zoomed past him and a hand reached out to grab Jenny. As Sykes pulled her inside, Oliver fell into the street. Georgette cowered behind a trash can. Fagin ran after the speeding limousine and the gang hurried out of the barge. Dodger approached the kitten.
You okay, kid?
Jenny? He took Jenny.
Don't worry. We'll get it back.
You will?
Hey, absolutely, kid.
Come on, man, let's go. Come on, go on, let's go.
All right, then. Let's do it.
Oliver and Georgette followed the gang past Fagin, who was struggling to start his scooter. Soon the gang arrived at Sykes' warehouse.
Oh, man, it don't look good.
It's all locked up, Dodger.
All right, there's got to be some way in.
Suddenly, Dodger remembered an old circus stunt that Francis used to do. He motioned to the bulldog, then scrounged through a trash bin until he found a battered football helmet. He placed Oliver inside, then rigged up a seesaw and aimed the catapult at a high window. Next, he instructed Francis to climb on a stack of crates.
Francis, you all set?
Farewell, Dulcinea.
Francis!
Peasants.
Ready, kid?
Yeah!
Go!
The heavy bulldog leaped off the crates and landed on one end of the seesaw, which sent the helmet flying through the window. Oliver quickly let the gang in, and they crept through the warehouse in search of Jenny. Suddenly, Dodger spotted a surveillance camera.
Yo, Tito, right, I'll check it out.
The Chihuahua climbed on top of the camera and chewed through the wires. Then the gang crept down the hall until they found Jenny. She was locked inside an office with Sykes standing guard beside her. To lure Sykes out of the room, the gang pretended to deliver a pizza. Sykes opened the door, and as he went down the hall, Oliver and the dogs ran into his office and untied Jenny.
Oh, Oliver! I thought I'd never see you again.
Dodger looked up at the monitor and saw Sykes and the Dobermans heading toward them. He instructed Francis to keep an eye on the monitors, then began frantically searching for a way to escape. He grinned when he saw a large hook dangling from the ceiling.
Yo, Tito, hot wire.
Hey, no way, Dodger, man. I've been barbecued too many times, man.
Good luck, Alonzo.
Huh?
I'll be waiting.
Georgette smiled at the Chihuahua. Inspired, Tito watched as the gang climbed on top of each other's backs to form a pyramid. Then he sprang to the top and activated an electric motor high above the warehouse floor. Soon a winch began to turn and the hook lowered to the ground. Einstein grabbed the hook with his teeth and placed it under the back of a chair. Jenny and the gang clambered aboard the chair, but as the winch carried them toward the ceiling, Sykes burst through the door. Dodger watched in horror as Sykes picked up an axe and plunged it into the electric wall panel. Jenny and the others fell to the ground. They raced out the door, but as they darted out of the warehouse, they were confronted once again by Sykes.
Well, this has all been very entertaining. But the party is over.
He heard a noise and whirled around. It was Fagin on his trike. Jenny and the gang jumped aboard and Fagin drove straight towards Sykes.
Fagin!
Sykes jumped out of the way and his Dobermans chased after the scooter. As Fagin maneuvered his trike down the road, Tito grinned at the enraged dogs.
Hey man, you're ugly! And you're uglier than him! And you're ugly part three! Hey, you're revenge on the ugly!
Suddenly, Tito saw Sykes' limousine careening toward them. Fagin guided his scooter over the curb onto the sidewalk, then disappeared down the steps to the subway. The car followed them into a tunnel and onto the subway tracks. The limousine pulled right up behind them, and when it bumped the trike from behind, Jenny lost her balance. She fell onto the limousine hood, and Sykes reached out and grabbed her arm. Ignoring the danger, Oliver and Dodger leaped onto the car to rescue Jenny. There was a blast of cold air as the car and scooter emerged under the Brooklyn Bridge. Still on the hood, Jenny reached her arms toward the trike.
Mr. Fagin, help me!
As Fagin struggled to reach Jenny, a train appeared headed straight in their direction. Just as it was about to hit them, Fagin hung from the rear of the trike and grabbed Jenny off the hood of Sykes' car. At the last moment, he seized the handlebars and turned sharply to the right. The train missed the scooter, but plowed straight into Sykes' car with Dodger and Oliver still on it. The limousine burst into pieces and fell off the bridge into the water below. The gang climbed off the scooter and stared at the floating wreckage. Dodger and the kitten were nowhere to be seen. Then, from the shadows, Dodger emerged carrying an unconscious Oliver in his mouth. Jenny ran to Dodger and gently lifted the kitten into her arms. The kitten stirred, and Jenny held him close.
Oliver! Oh, my Oliver!
A few days later, Fagin and the gang gathered at Jenny's house to celebrate a special occasion.
Don't forget to make a wish, Jennifer.
Smiling, Jenny looked around the table at her friends. She paused when she saw Oliver, then bent over the cake and blew out all 8 candles. In the kitchen, Winston heard the phone ring.
Mr. Foxworth!
Shh, shh, shh. My goodness, you're back tomorrow? Oh, she'll be so surprised to see you. Yes, goodbye, sir.
Winston joined the others in the living room where Jenny was opening presents. When she finished, Fagin motioned to the dogs.
Francis, Rita, Tito, Vaminos, the streets are calling.
Have we forgotten anything?
Jenny looked at the box of loot, her gift from the gang. She held up an old tennis shoe.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, everyone. The gifts were great.
Jenny stood up and kissed Fagin goodbye.
Bye, Mr. Fagin, and thank you.
Oh, bye-bye, Jenny.
Blushing, Fagin bowed to the little girl. Then he turned to the gang.
Let's go!
Bye-bye.
Oh, Oliver, we shall meet again.
See you around, kid.
Oh, goodbye, you guys.
Dodger was the last to leave. He ambled over to Oliver and winked at him.
Hey, you're okay. For a cat. We'll keep a spot open for you in the gang. Vice President, Uptown Chapter.
Oliver beamed as Dodger ran to catch up with the others. Jenny and Oliver waved goodbye as the gang took off on Fagin's trike, heading downtown. The scooter weaved through the traffic, and soon it was just a tiny speck. One more vehicle making its way through the crazy, crowded streets of New York City.